So what is lava, and why is it important, and how can we study it? Well, volcanic eruptions are one of the most spectacular events on Earth, and in the context of our day-to-day lives, it would be easy for most of us to just think of them as isolated events that occur in remote areas and don't really impact our lives very strongly, unless, of course, it happens to be a volcanic eruption that disrupts airline travel, for example. But from a geological perspective, we see volcanic eruptions as a fundamental process that incrementally has changed the Earth and influenced life on our planet. It's also fundamental to the way other planets have developed. Let's talk for a moment about where volcanoes occur. It turns out on our planet, volcanoes occur in very predictable places, as dictated by the larger motions of the outer shell of the Earth. This movement of the outer shell of the Earth that's broken up into a number of different large rafts, about 100 kilometers thick, is called plate tectonics. And volcanoes occur in very specific plate tectonic settings, mostly on the edges of those plates where they bump into each other, pull apart, or slide past one another. Very visible volcanic eruptions take place where the plates are coming together. One plate is usually pushed beneath the other one, and parts of the Earth's surface are sort of being recycled back into the Earth. This process produces very violent volcanic eruptions, and these are exemplified by the ones that we see in the so-called Pacific Ring of Fire. These are all places where the Earth's outer shell, its lithosphere, is being recycled by pushing part of the Earth's surface back down into the mantle where it will melt again. That process produces these very large volcanic island chains and volcanic ranges like the Andes. Another important place that we see volcanoes that are very visible to us are in what are called hotspots, just fixed areas on the Earth where melting takes place and volcanic islands form, such as Hawaii or Iceland. Yellowstone's another good example. These places are fixed, and as those lithosphere plates move across the surface of the Earth, they leave a trail of volcanoes on the surface. But the most important, the most voluminous volcanic activity on our planet takes place on the bottom of the ocean, at the so-called mid-ocean ridges. These are the edges of plates that are pulling apart. In these settings, molten material is rising from deep inside the Earth and erupting on the surface in sort of a giant crack that continuously heals itself as the plates move apart. Even though this is the most important, most voluminous of volcanism on our planet, it's really not very visible to us because it's hidden by a mile or more of water. Still, volcanic eruptions on a geologic timescale must go on almost continuously there. In fact, when we look at our planet, we see the continents and the oceans. About 60% of our planet is covered by ocean, but that ocean is hiding huge fields of lava that have been created at those mid-ocean ridges as the plates have moved apart and repaved the bottom of the ocean over and over again. So volcanic activity that makes the seafloor is actually the most important volcanic activity on our planet. And most of that volcanic activity makes basaltic lava, this black basaltic lava, exactly what we study in the Syracuse Lava Project. Lava comes in lots of different compositions, and those compositions vary mainly because of the amount of silica in the lava. More silica makes the lava more viscous, less silica makes it runnier or lower viscosity. The low viscosity lava that we see flowing in streams most commonly is called basalt. It's a black lava and it's very common. It's erupted on the bottom of the ocean and in places like Hawaii and Iceland. So let's have a closer look at volcanic activity on Earth. Perhaps the first thing to know is that the volcanic products kind of come in two different kinds of shapes and forms, and formed by different processes. One type that forms by violent explosion and basically the blowing apart of molten material near volcanic centers is called pyroclastic material. It mostly piles up close to volcanoes, but in the most violent eruptions, that material is also blown into the stratosphere and can even cover the globe as it moves into our atmosphere. Both volcanic material, that is particles, volcanic ash, as well as gases are blown into the atmosphere. And in fact, they have the capability to change our climate on the short term or even on the long term. The material we study here at Syracuse is lava. Lava is the second kind of material that comes out of volcanoes. It comes out the edges of large volcanic structures and piles up with the pyroclastic material to make large volcanic cones that we've all seen. But it also leaks out of giant cracks or fissures in the seafloor and other places. It just sort of oozes out and pours across the surface of the Earth as it cools. The most important place where this happens on our planet is at the mid-ocean ridges, this ring of mountain ranges that wind for about 60,000 kilometers, sort of like the seams of the baseball around our planet. The place where the lavas are coming out is extremely narrow, just a kilometer or so wide. Although we've never seen an active volcanic eruption on the mid-ocean ridge system, recent volcanic eruptions in the Western Pacific give us a really good idea of what volcanic eruptions might look like on mid-ocean ridge spreading centers. The West Mount volcano is in a subduction zone setting, but it still gives us a basic idea of what those seafloor eruptions might look like. That lava is generated as the Earth's lithosphere plates are pulled apart. Material rises beneath it to fill that widening gap, and as it rises, the material begins to melt. Because the melt is much less dense than the surrounding rock, it rises very rapidly to the surface, sort of like a way a hot air balloon rises to the top of a room. It beats the solid material that's also moving upward to the surface. Much of that material will solidify before it reaches the surface, just because it begins to feel the cool outer surface of the Earth as it rises. But some of it will leak out onto the surface as lava. At mid-ocean ridges, we see this very narrow crack that I mentioned before, and the lava spills out and spills down the edges of the mountain range. So we have very fresh-looking basaltic lava all over the seafloor along those edges. As the plates move apart, that lava moves with it laterally away from the mid-ocean ridge spreading center, and new lava is erupted right at the axis. And we can see these beautiful scalloped lava flows cascading out of those fissures. As that lava pours out, it takes on many different shapes. One of the typical shapes is called pillow lavas, and as the name suggests, it's sort of rounded, bulbous blobs that are usually about a meter across, something like that, maybe more about the size of your pillow. And they pile up in this sort of lumpy pile. And most of the lava on the seafloor has that form. Other lavas on the seafloor come out in very smooth-looking sheets that can be more than a mile long. And in some cases, those sheets are folded and rumpled up or broken up in various ways. Well, the seafloor is not the only place we have lava, of course. In fact, even if we look at our moon, the dark spots on the moon, the man in the moon's face, those are vast seas of lava called the lunar mare. These areas were produced by melting that occurred during major impact events on the moon, but these are vast seas of the same material that we work with here at Syracuse. Mars is another place where there's extensive lava flows. If you look at the Pathfinder missions, the current rover missions to Mars, you'll be able to see lots of lava there. In fact, the biggest volcano in the solar system, Olympus Mons, 600 kilometers across at the base and 25 kilometers high, is a very large volcanic feature as well. Lava plays an important role in the early history of almost all planets, and certainly in all the planets of our solar system. As planets are first formed from dust clouds that begin to collapse upon one another, crushed together by gravity, and then pounded by various meteor impacts, together with radiogenic heat, the planet starts out very hot and then slowly cools through time. This is what the Earth's been doing. The Earth, probably about 4.5 billion years ago, soon after it formed, probably had large magma oceans or lava oceans all over its surface. And probably the same has been true for other planets close to the Sun in our solar system. In fact, there's ongoing volcanic activity elsewhere in our solar system. For example, on the moons of Jupiter, Io in particular, it's the most active volcanic center in our entire solar system. So lava plays a fundamental role in the way planets develop, and it's a fundamental building block in building new planetary real estate. In fact, that's how we made those vast areas on the bottom of the ocean. So even though it may not seem like there's active lava flows or eruptions in your own backyard, lava plays a very fundamental role in the way our planet has developed and a very fundamental role in how other planets have developed.